Good morning, everyone. And today I'm going to talk for next half an hour regarding the topic which I've chosen today is cyber unsafe, where I'm saying we will become cyber safe. And because criminals are trying to target us. So the topic is cyber safe and how not to be the target of cyber criminals. In this talk, basically, I will discuss about, what all can go wrong with us, how criminals are exploiting technology users, what they do so that they can easily target technology users for doing computer frauds and cybercrime, and how a little bit of change in our browsing habits and usage of technology can safeguard us against the cyber criminals. That is what I'm going to discuss overall. I work for Ministry of Electronics and IT. However, the views expressed in this talk are my personal views. So, what makes crime possible for criminals? Or rather, what makes cybercrime possible for criminals? Why do the crime happen? The crime happens because of us. It's us, the cyberspace users, who make it easy for criminals to exploit us. It is us who do not take care, do not take enough precaution, do not worry about what can go wrong. Hence, it becomes very, very easy for cyber criminals to exploit each one of us. And that is what cyber criminals rely on. And if we are able to change that, if we are able to just take some precaution, if we are able to know how they do crime against us, it becomes very difficult for criminals to do crime. They are still able to do, but then we can make their life very, very difficult by just changing some habits. And that's what's going to be discussed going forward. So what all is happening is along with cyber users who are actually, okay. So, topic was cyber unsafe, as I have discussed. So I'll move on. And I was discussing why crimes become possible, and crime becomes possible because of all of us. We all help criminal carry out frauds because we are not vigilant enough. And then, convergence of technology, all technology users wants convenience. And this convenience is happening at the cost of convergence, because as our mobile phones, if you see, my mobile phone is my camera, my mobile phone is my handycam, my digital diary, my internet browser. So it can do all the activity of a laptop. Basically, all the technological devices are converging, making technology complex to provide convenience to the user. And this complexity with the rapid change of speed of change of technology makes all of us, all of technological users prone to cybercrimes. Because my mobile phone contains all the data, including photographs, videos, criminals are after exploiting my mobile phones. They want to get into my mobile phone. They develop methods by developing phishing techniques, by installing malwares. So by hook or crook, by installing some softwares like AnyDesk. So they try to do all the means of technological advancements to get into the phone of a user so that they can exploit him by compromising his data. So this convergence is giving them opportunity that they have to only compromise one device instead of various devices which they have to do in past. So this convergence of technology is one reason that crime is increasing, but also the same way, if we are able to preserve, if we are able to make sure that nobody is able to get into our mobile phones, we can actually solve or prevent a lot of frauds. So, criminals are very smart. Criminals deceive humans by manipulating their emotions. So if you see all the frauds which are happening today, they are not happening just because they are able to develop new methods. It is because they are able to develop methods which are exploiting our emotions. So if we see in past what all has happened with us, what all frauds criminals were able to do, which now we know very well how they used to do, we will realize that almost all the crimes were happening because of exploitation of some kind of emotions. The basic emotions like trust, somebody is calling from the bank, somebody is sending me a payment link, and I believe it, that it is the person who is calling me onto the phone is somebody from the bank. I'm trusting. And because of that trust, I'm going to go for, trap. I'm going to fall for a fraud. Somebody who's buying something from me on a secondhand website is sending me a link where he's saying, I'm going to, if you scan this and this will give you the money. I'm trusting that person to do all the right things. I'm trusting that person to be the right person. Whereas the person might be malicious. He might be sending a link for receiving payments instead of giving payments. So trust is an emotion which people are exploiting. Greed, we have seen from long, long time back, each one of us has got an email saying we have $1 million. We have inherited a great amount of property. or you know some very lucrative, extremely lucrative scheme, or some free stuff which we are getting for which we have to pay something or go to a particular link. All this is greed. Basically, they're exploiting greed. They will keep on developing new stories of greed where we can fall for them. Then next is panic. They will give us some panic stories saying that your card will be blocked if you don't act in 5 minutes. Your account has been hacked, and if you don't do something now, which the link which I'm sharing, and do not fill the information, your account will be misused or compromised or blocked. So they will put you into a scenario where your panic emotion is triggered, and many of us, after the panic emotion is triggered, fall for a trap, and you know we are exploited. Fear of missing out. You know, we get an offer saying this offer expires in 5 minutes. If you don't act and don't click on that link and fill details, you know, you will lose out on to something very important, which most people are probably enjoying. So you know, this is also an emotion which is being exploited. Threat that, you know, somebody your near and dear one is in an accident and he's hospitalized, his phone is with me, I'm calling, and you do these transactions so that this person can be saved or this person can be helped, and all such stories. Then this is very important, the disruption. Disruption is an aspect where, you know, whenever technological changes are happening, they are the, you know, the prime spots where criminals try to put their trap. You know, it's like when RFID tags became mandatory for toll plazas let's say tomorrow was the last date. And, you know, many people who did not have RFID tags, they were frantically searching on websites to find out, you know, what should they do? Where can they buy? In that panic, in their disruption scenario, criminals, you know, send out fake links, phishing links, malicious links, where, you know, user out of panic and disruption, you know, fall for some of them, some of the schemes which were floated around exploiting disruptions. In case of demonetization, when demonetization happened, a lot of wallet-related frauds happened because people were not using wallets very often, and disruption of demonetization caused them to switch over to wallets. And since people were moving on to wallets, they were not aware, you know, they were doing all sorts of things, all sorts of schemes, all sorts of traps were laid by criminals. So basically what happens is, criminals are very smart. They know these basic emotions of humans can always be exploited. So they keep on changing the stories, you know, calling from the bank to the phishing link to next generation stories. They will keep on changing the stories. They will never change the emotions. So stories change, not the emotions. The emotions being exploited remains the same. So if we can control our emotions, if we can understand that a person might be playing with our emotion, trying to give us a story, to make us act on those stories because our emotions are being exploited, leads us to computer frauds and cyber crimes. So, you know, you may not know all the stories, but if you can understand, whenever somebody is giving you any information or a story, you must try to find out, is he trying to exploit my emotions or not? If the answer is yes, even if there is a hint of, emotions being exploited, that should be a red flag for you. You should not move ahead. You should probably rethink of what needs to be done instead of acting what somebody is telling you to act. So this is a technology, digital technological era where, you know, technology is playing with the, you know, we have a lot of advanced technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning. We have so much of information overload. All this can actually lead us to believe in things which may not be real. You know, in today's era, aankho dekhi and kaano suni may also not be true. We have to take anything and everything with a pinch of salt so that criminals are not able to exploit us. So this is very important. So, you know, till now we are treating the symptoms rather than the root cause. It's like, you know, we are treating fever, but the root cause might be some kind of infection in the stomach. Similarly, in case of cyber crime and computer frauds, you know, there has to be some effect which is we are treating, but there has to be some root cause. We need to understand that root cause is the exploitation of emotions. Root cause is how humans work. That is well understood by criminals. Criminals understand the psychology of the human beings. They understand the psychology of technology users, and that's where they plan their activities. That's where they plan their traps. Keeping in mind, they can exploit human emotions. And hence, you know, in light of cause-effect principles and Locard's principle, famous Locard principle, which each one of us know, which says every contact leaves a trace, which means you cannot come into the contact of an environment without changing it in some way. You know, we need to understand that when criminal is trying to do something to us, there is an underlying plan, there is an underlying cause through which he is trying to exploit us. And when he's doing so, he's leaving some evidences into the network, into the environment, including digital technology environment, as per the Locard principle, which can actually be very, very good for the people who are developing solutions. So this talk, when I'm talking about, you know, what can go wrong, I'm also talking about researchers and the problem solvers who want to take up this area. They should always believe that the Locard principle and cause effect principle always gives you the starting point to solve a problem in terms of identifying where could be the potential evidences, what technique and solution and methodology they should develop, which can identify the artifacts which are being left as a result of Locard's principle, which means when a criminal is doing any criminal activity, malicious activity, he's coming in contact of you as a victim and the devices, his devices and your devices are interacting. That means there are digital artifacts being exchanged. And if you can identify and quantify these digital artifacts which has changed, those are your evidences. Those will give you digital forensic solutions. Those will be your research solutions. Those will be your commercial solutions. And this is a lucrative area. Digital forensics offers so much of low-hanging fruit that if you take up this area as a researcher and develop solutions, you not only can you publish research paper and develop tools which can be used by various law enforcement and other investigative agencies, it can also earn revenue for you. It can save a lot of forex for the country. Right now, we are spending 5,000-6,000 crore rupees every year as a forex outgo for using tools and technologies developed by people outside India. So, you know, this is a lucrative area to take up your career where you understand what all is going wrong, identify the, you know, causes, and based on Locard's principle, you can develop solutions which will be used by investigative agencies. One important fact which I always talk about is criminals are most creative but extremely lazy people on earth. You know, they are not interested to do fraud against one particular person. They're interested to do fraud against some person, whosoever it might be. They will not go after one particular person until unless there is a specific reason. Mostly they are after money or data or some valuable which you have. So idea is they will try to lay their trap for hundreds and thousands of people. Whosoever is easy to capture, whosoever is falling for these traps easily, they will do fraud. If you become little tough nut to crack, they will actually spare you. They will not go after you. So the idea is for a common technology user, if you understand how criminals do frauds, if you understand their technology, if you understand their methodology and psychology, you can take some simple precautions. And then in that case, you will not be the one which is easy to do fraud against. And hence you will be spared. They will do fraud against those people who are little more careless, little more carefree, and are not knowing, you know, what's going on. So understanding these and appreciating these traits will also help developing solutions for the researchers. So this is, you know, helping both the parties, general users, as well as the researchers who are interested to develop solutions. So example of creativity, you know, there are hundreds of examples starting from, you know, mining social media for various things. They can do conventional frauds like robbery by becoming a Facebook friend of yours, where you share any of your photograph. Your photograph may contain metadata and exif data like your home location, camera details, which can give them your home address and that you are not in home, and they can go and do a conventional robbery to something which is more, you know, they can send you a link of malicious games or internet games or online games where they can give you a malware. They can try to put you, you know, make you addicted, where you can, they can force you to spend money. They can lure by providing something free. This is very, very common. Most of the crimes where, you know, something free is given is very easy to do. For example, if you are going to a parking lot and if you find a USB drive, you know, near your car, what will you do? Most of the users pick up that USB drive because this is a free USB drive you got. As soon as you plug this free USB into your computer, you know, some malicious software will be installed in your computer. It will be a keylogger. They will exploit you. They will take up your data, username, password, and such details, which will actually compromise and probably lead to a fraud. So free is not good. You know, free is mostly not good. You know, it's like you go to, let's say, an airport and your phone is out of charge and you use the USB cable given as free charge onto some places. What can happen is that there might be malware which can be installed into your phones when you are connecting for charging your phone free of cost without your own cable. So then that's a problem. So solution could be as simple as that instead of charging your phone on any of these free places where you're getting free electricity and free data cable, you charge your power bank instead of your phone. And then from power bank, you charge your phone so that power bank can, they can't install a virus in a power bank. because it doesn't have any operating system or any computing media. Once it is charged, you can then take this charge to your phone. So there could be very, very simple non-technical methods which can be used where you can safeguard against frauds and, you know, simple precautions you can take which will make sure that, you know, you are not falling for the frauds. So artificial intelligence, machine learning are being used to generate deep fakes. Fakes means fake news to fake document to fake product. Everything is being fake today. So there are technological solutions which can help you detect fake news. You can go to PIB sites, there are fact checkers. Then fake documents, then there are solutions which can be used to identify if a particular piece of printer or a scanner has been used in generation of a particular document or not. So these kind of solutions also exist. So many times a common user thinks if something has gone wrong, nothing can be done about it. Whereas on the contrary, there are hundreds of solutions developed by researchers, probably not used commercially, are available for problems which most people are not even aware of. So the idea is people should be made aware. Users should find out what all can happen to them and what are the solutions which exist. You know, I will discuss going forward some of the common myths also, which most of us have, and I will try to correct those myths by giving you the right information. So technology is being creatively used by criminals to develop interesting ways of doing fraud against normal users, and that's going to increase. You know, social media has brought distant people closer, but has created distance between people who are close to each other. This is a famous epigram I use, that social media is being used by criminals. You know, somebody who might be a friend of yours may not be actually your friend. He might be using a fake photograph and fake data to make friendship to you, to mine your data. So these are something important we should take care. We should have verified people as your social media friends. Instead of having 2000 friends, have 200 friends. But all of them should be the real known people whom you know physically, have met physically, have not only met online. Because, you know, in that case, you don't know who might be the person who might be using a fake image and fake name to lure you and to befriend you and then mining your data. So idea of this talk is to change your perspective about crime. There's something on the screen. I don't know how many of you can see. It might be looking like a blocks or some modern art to you. But there is something which you can read. Some of you could actually read, and some of you can read it now. It is LIFT. So earlier it did not have lines and it was difficult to read. When I put these lines, you can read it easily. The idea is if you know about how people do crime, how they exploit your emotions, then you are aware. Then you will look forward for these signs that somebody is trying to exploit you. So computer fraud and cybercrime is basically about perspective. Knowing the perspective of criminals and their tricks can safeguard most of us from the crime which they are going to do against us. So the idea is we need to have researchers' perspective as well as awareness perspective. If we are aware, we can safeguard against crime. And if we are a researcher and we are aware and observant, we can develop solutions against these kind of problems which are being created by computer fraud and cyber criminals. I'm also writing all these things in the form of a book, which probably will be coming in July sometime, where I'm talking about tools, techniques, methodologies, and stories on how to be cyber safe instead of cyber unsafe, along with my co-author, Dr. Garima Gupta. This is easy to read. I think I will read it for you, and you can also try to read it yourself. If you read it fast, you know, it says, I could not believe that I could actually understand what I'm reading using the incredible power of the human mind, according to the research at Cambridge University. It does not matter in what order the letters in the words are. The important thing is that first and the last letter in the right place. The rest can be a total mess and you can still read it without a problem. This is because human mind does not read every letter by itself, but the word as a whole. Amazing, right? And I always thought spelling is important. So this particular paragraph, probably a kid cannot read. 5, 7, 6-year-old kid will find it difficult because everything is jumbled, but an adult can read it easy. It is because human mind is intelligent. And you know, when we apply this intelligence, you know, we do things automatically. It's like driving a car. Once you know how to drive a car, it automatically happens. Similarly, criminals exploit these things. You know, when you are installing a software in Windows, you are saying next, next, next. When you're installing an app on your Android phone, you're agreeing to everything without reading anything. So what they do is they send out some notification, they send out some links where you instinctively click. And once you click, a drive-by, you know, malware is installed on your computer, you're taken to a phishing link, and all such things happen because they're exploiting your intelligence, they're exploiting your muscle movements, motor movements, which are automatic, like reading all these things. And that's where they are developing very creative frauds, which can happen against you. So we need to understand that at times intelligence can be misused against us. We need to be careful. We need to take a step back. We should not act in hurry in digital world. In case of doubt, we should back out in digital world and go back and verify and then restart the things. Right? So we say social media is fun. Yes, it is fun. As long as you take precautions and, you know, in reality, it depends, because whatever you post, you know, can be misused against you. Whatever data you create remains there forever. You know, you might be freaked out if you know how much Google and Facebook know about you. If you just go to these, let's say, takeout.google.com, for each one of us, there is at least 5 to 10 GB of data, if not more, which you can download. So if on takeout.google.com, if you go and then you request for your information, your own information, they will give you a link in a few hours, which you can download, and you will be astonished that, you know, what all have you done in last 10 years? You may not remember. Everything is being remembered by Google. And at times this could be a goldmine for law enforcement agency and investigators also, because they can find out where you were, what point of time you were, who else was with you. And, you know, they can take out Google information with your consent from various people, they can draw the map of whom you met, what time you met, when did you do a speed violation, because Google also records your speed of movement when you're driving in a car. So they can actually find out traffic violation you are doing on a road which is 70 kilometers per hour. If you're driving 90 kilometers per hour, that is data is also being recorded. So, you know, it is very, very different world today. You know, without our knowledge, so much of data being generated by each one of us, that the potential of use and misuse both exist, and we must be aware. We also may be thinking that, okay, you know, anybody can be a computer fraud and cybercrime investigator. Probably yes, as long as you are trained well. You know, bootstrapping is required. It can't be that, you know, one fine day I will say I'm an investigator. You need to study, you need to have bootstrapping of information given to you. And then you need to constantly update and read and find out what's going on. As I told, digital technology is changing very, very fast. There's a rapid change of technology. So that by the time you understand a particular solution, particular fraud, particular tool and technology moves on. Many of us might be still using a laptop which is having a CD and DVD drive, but we don't use CD and DVD because of 4G and USBs. And, you know, pen drives become, or SSD became so cheap. So, you know, technology is outdating much, much faster than what ever happened in our lifetime. So we need to know that, we need to understand what exists commercially as well as in academia and research world, so that we can use those solutions before they become outdated. That is very important. So this is an area where a lot of reading, a lot of constant updation is required. And then, yes, most of us can be investigator after a due training and due understanding of facts and tools has been done. There are courses which are coming up in academia. There are master programs, undergraduate programs, and PhD programs. That also is something which should be taken up, because academic research leading to commercial solutions is the answer to the meanness of computer frauds and cyber crimes, right? So I'll skip some of the slides because of lack of time. Most of us know that press delete and data is gone. So data is never gone. Once you create a piece of data, it remains, right? It never goes. It depends on your capability, your ability, understanding that can you get it back? It may be costly to get it back. It may require a lot of efforts, but it is always available. So never create a piece of electronic data, video, audio, or text, which you don't want, you know, to be retained, right? Because it may come back to haunt you. Many people are creating some information, some electronic piece of data in form of videos, you know, private videos or some audios or text. I think you should be very careful, because once it goes out, once it is created, it remains. So never create such information which you don't want to haunt you. Data and timestamps of data. This is again a controversial area, because digital data can be tampered with. Data and timestamps are very easy to tamper. It is not very reliable until you use forensic tools. So it is not that, you know, on face of it, it may look like, you know, it is not possible. Like here, it says the file has been created in 2003, where it has been modified in 2001. Very difficult to prove in court of law. But tools and technology is available. If you use forensic methodologies, you can prove why this has happened, because physically overwriting is possible and this can be tinkered with. So you must know as an investigator, as a researcher, that how technology can be misused and how to identify those footsteps of misuse, how to find out the footsteps and the footprints of where tampering has been done. Criminals are techo geeks is a myth, because if you know more, you are scared. If you don't know much, then you can use technology for malicious purpose also. Most people don't go and hack Googles and the Facebooks of the world. Rather, they use social engineering. They go to user end, they install keyloggers, they install viruses, they install malicious softwares, or they exploit design flaws to do all these kind of frauds. So frauds typically can be stopped if a user is aware, he follows due precautions, instead of just worrying about how Facebook and Google will safeguard my data. I think this also I will skip for the lack of time. It is difficult to commit identity theft is not true. It is very easy to do identity theft. Identity theft techniques are changing. Once upon a time, people were using some kind of skimmers, but today they are not using skimmers. You go to a petrol pump, if you are paying a credit card, they will not be using skimmers. They will be doing transaction in front of you. But what they would be doing probably is they would be putting a camera in a video recording mode on just near to where they are swiping your card to the machine. In that case, your front and the back portion of the card will be video recorded onto the mobile phone, because you don't know whether the mobile phone is on video mode or on or not. And once that information is captured, that can be misused to do transactions. And you must be wondering, without OTP, how a transaction can be done? If I have to do an international transaction, until you have disabled your international transaction onto your net banking, I can actually buy a laptop in bestbuy.com in US and ship it to Singapore. And because of multilateral and multiple countries involved, it will be very difficult for you to, you know, act smoothly, fast, and your transaction will happen and you will be in dispute. It will take months, if not days, for, you know, transaction to get settled, if at all get settled in your favor. So the idea is, criminals are moving on from techniques, older techniques to newer techniques every now and then. You need to catch up and understand and read about what they are doing today so that you can safeguard. The very simple trick, or rather advice, which even banks tell you, is remove your CVV number at the back of your card, which 95% of people don't do. Right? Anti-forensics, because criminals are becoming smart. These days, criminals are not the old conventional criminals which use power. Today's criminals are using technology. They are smart. They are reading. They are updating themselves. So they use anti-forensic techniques so their data does not remain. Forensics becomes difficult. But one thing they forget is Locard's principle again. Locard principle says there might be more evidences for which techniques may not exist today. But if researcher friend of mine can develop techniques like DNA, right? You know, in 1800, if some murder happened, at the crime scene, the hair of the person who murdered was there, but it was not of any use. But later on, when the DNA technique came, those hairs became useful and somebody could find out who did the murder. Similarly, today we may not be able to solve some of the crimes. There might be evidences, but we are not able to have techniques. But going forward, if we develop, we all involve ourselves in research and develop techniques, those techniques can help us develop solutions which can then solve unsolved crimes of today, which can give us better and efficient methods, which can be used to safeguard against computer frauds and cyber crimes. Internet and online gaming addiction is real, and that is where these techniques are devised. You know, starting from Facebook to Google to all social media and all games, they are designed keeping psychology of the user in mind so that they become addictive. Because once you are hooked to these devices, once you are using them more, then only their revenue grows. So they are designed keeping in mind that, you know, you are hooked onto those things. You know, at times it is very difficult for users, because, you know, users are taking selfies and making videos for TikTok and Reels in dangerous locations. And, you know, this is becoming difficult. So idea is, all stakeholders, parents, teachers, have to counsel students and the youngsters that these are traps. They should limit their uses. I'm not saying they should not use it. Use it in a way that it cannot be misused against you. In today's world, survival of the most aware is the mantra. You know, if you are aware, if you know how things are happening, how criminals are doing crime, then only you can be safeguarded against these crimes. So you must be making conscious effort to become aware by finding out how and what criminals are planning and doing these days, because they will change their techniques. Old techniques will become outdated. They will not go and repeat those techniques forever. They will move on to new ones. Right? They're using UPI frauds, as we saw in case of pandemic. We had PM Care at SBI, the original ID, and there were so many variations which were made, which were being circulated, and people donated on those. They wanted to donate for a good cause, but it went to the criminals. So the idea is, they will, you know, exploit your psychology. They will play with, you know, zero and O's. They will play with I and ones, which, you know, we are finding it difficult to, you know, differentiate. So freeze bat, which I have discussed, juice jacking, lost and found USBs, are the methods used by criminals to lure you. So no, never use a USB which is not yours, which you have not bought, because you don't know what it contains. Never charge your phone to unknown USB cable, because it may, you know, again, install something on your phone and you never know your data might be stolen. So you must try that if something is free, then that, you know, that free is not a product. You are the product. You are being misused. Your data is being misused. Right? Hardware keyloggers. This is important. You know, desktops, most of the enterprise desktops, nobody goes and check at the back of the CPU where a keyboard and mouse wires get connected. There could be a small piece of hardware device which is connected to your keyboard wire at the end of the CPU, which is a hardware keylogger. Nobody, no antivirus, no investigating software can detect a hardware keylogger. You have to physically inspect your back of your CPU for finding out a hardware keylogger. So these kind of things happen, and prevention is better than the cure. It is also applicable in the digital world. Most of us are not taking enough precautions, preventions. We think technology, you know, we think that nothing will happen to us. It's like a scenario where, you know, happy-go-lucky. We think, I will not put on helmet because I'm just going somewhere near, and then accident can happen. Similarly, we must understand in digital world, as soon as we are online, we don't know who is seeing us, who can do what to us. We should always take prevention, and that's where we can be safe in digital world. These are some of the resources which can be used for digital forensic research and academia related research papers and information and news, which could be of use to you. One more fact is that once upon a time, it used to be the case that wealthier you are immune to the crime. Today, the cyber crime has tipped it other way. If you are wealthier, you know, you are not immune, rather criminals are after you. That means you're using more technology, that means you're having more gadgets, that means you are more susceptible, more prone to a crime. If you are having a smartphone versus a feature phone, people with smartphone, criminals have more opportunity against them if they are not taking enough precautions. So the idea is you should take enough precautions, understand what is going wrong, what can go wrong. So these are some of the things in limited half an hour I could discuss. I wished I had more time where I could have gone in detail. Maybe if you have any query, you can always contact me. As and when, maybe in July sometime, I will have the book. You can probably subscribe to the book, and you know, you can note down the name Cyber Unsafe, and then in July you can probably find it, and it will be available for everyone of you to probably go in detail and read. And that's all from my side.